well introduce myself. My name is Siumi Maria Tam. I'm, I guess, a Chinese person born and raised in Hong Kong, and very passionate about anthropology. My friend said when I talk about anthropology, my eyes light up, so tells you how much I like it. But increasingly, I was thinking, you know, what can you do with an academic discipline? Been studying anthropology for a long time and teaching anthropology for a long time at Paris University. And I was thinking in this past few years that I should do something about it, with it, before I retire, I guess. So here is what I want to share with you about my project. Is that all right? Because the background is a bit dark. Is that all right to see, or should we turn some of these off? Here? Okay. All right, good. So I come up with this fancy title called Otherizing South Asians versus Realizing Intercultural Sensibility. And it tells you what I've been doing. In the past few years, I've been working with the Indian community, the Nepalese community, the Pakistani, Sri Lankan, and Bangladesh communities, basically the South Asian communities in Hong Kong. And the reason why I was doing this was because I think as somebody who has studied cross-cultural knowledge, who has been working with cross-cultural knowledge, need to be able to understand our own society. I've been working in Hong Kong, you're living in Hong Kong for so long. What can I do with this knowledge that I have? Now, we have been here in Hong Kong for quite a few years now, right? Most of you, most of us. And have you heard this phrase called, Hong Kong is the place where East meets West? Do you agree with it?
Yes.
You proud of it? Okay. I'm so glad that you have that response. This is actually my response. Like, okay, so if I don't belong to the East and I don't belong to the West, where do I stand? And this is exactly how the South Asians feel in Hong Kong. So if you're an Indian, Nepalese, Pakistani, Bangladeshi, Sri Lankan, Afghan, or you know, from Bhutan. What do you do? How do you situate yourself? How do you create an identity for yourself? And in Hong Kong, most of the time, these groups are being marginalized. So what I want to talk with you about is these three things. One, how do South Asians get to be otherized? Now, this is not a fancy academic term. It just means being created or made into the others. You don't belong to the mainstream. You're not us. You're them. So we otherize the South Asians in Hong Kong, and I want to discuss a little bit what I have been doing with my students, you know, creating a project to see what we can do about it, and I'm sure you can do something about it. So the next thing is to talk about what can you do, and the third thing, I want to propose some measures that you can use to measure your success. Right? Okay, so let's start with, you know, what is it about the South Asians in Hong Kong? You don't get a lot of this in South China Morning Post. You do get a lot of this in mainstream Chinese press. Okay. So what we are seeing is something like this. This is an extreme case, Oriental Day. Portraying the South Asians as a troop of robbers and thieves. This is exactly what it says if you read Chinese. Nanya Bingkan. They are like soldiers, fierce. They're running around, stealing, robbing. And what do they do here? North Point, they robbed $100,000 worth of salary. So somebody who's going to be, you know, not being able to take bread home because, you know, the salary got robbed. This one, this is even worse because it says, South Asian robber stole potato chips in a convenience store. Got caught red-handed, but he attacked the owner with a knife, and the owner is now in critical condition. Now, if you look at this one, you will find that it is being portrayed as, you know, South Asians are being portrayed like, you know, they're all thieves, they're all robbers, they're all fierce people, no good. But this is one thing. But then, using that kind of imagery to call everybody else that look a little bit South Asian, maybe, you know, you have a darker skin color or something of that sort, you get stereotyped into a even worse person by calling you a murderer, basically. It turns out that in this particular case, the robber was not South Asian at all. This is a Vietnamese. Not to say that all Vietnamese again, let me that very clearly. We shouldn't be even stereotyping Vietnamese, but in this particular case, the person was a Vietnamese man from Canada. Nothing to do with South Asian, but the South Asians got the blame. So I think the lesson is that we have all these kinds of misinformation going on in Hong Kong. We've got all these kinds of stereotypical images going on in Hong Kong. And what are we doing? Essentially, we are otherizing them, putting them outside of our mainstream society. We don't want them to be part of us. It focuses, the process of otherization focuses on the differences. They don't look like us, they don't talk like us, they don't even speak our language, they can't read Chinese, they can't do the same kinds of jobs, they're just born different. Now, this is also wrong, but a lot of times you hear mainstream Chinese talking like that. It's very saddening. And what do? You put a boundary, you draw a line between us, Chinese, mainstream, and them. They are not us. Despite, in fact, I just want to add, despite the fact that we use a lot of South Asian cultural practices, how many of you do yoga? How many of you eat curry? Yeah, every day, right? Where do these come from? Now, in mainstream Chinese society, we do exactly the same. Curry dishes, they're in all of our tartan tans, these local style cafes. We eat curry every day. We never think where these come from. Now, what have the South Asians contributed to Hong Kong? It's never crossed their minds. And so this is a problem. Right? The boundary is drawn, why? To reinforce certain kinds of interests. Essentially, we are all interest groups. We want to defend our interests, and we want to keep other people out. And it turns very emotional. And because it's all based on a lot of misinformation, many of these things are really very irrational. You don't really think logically, thoroughly, before you make a decision of who these other people are. And so, what do we call it? In anthropology, we call it a process of construction. It's a construction of reality. It doesn't mean that it's all wrong. Some parts of it is right, because it's got a bit of information here and there. But it's somehow subjectively put together and interpreted. Right? So, it is, again, reinforced by stereotypes. We just keep thinking that South Asians are all like that. Look at one South Asian who is a thief, and everybody else is a thief. It's like telling the Chinese, right? I remember when I was an exchange student, that it was on board the semester at sea, the boat. And so one of my classmates asked me, where are you from? Hong Kong. Oh, okay, that's nice. Which part of Japan is that? It's really not. It's quite a bit of distance from Japan. But okay, so what are you? I'm a Chinese. Oh, you're Chinese. All right, you must play ping pong. Oh my goodness, I can't do any sports. I'm not an athlete at all. Oh, then you must do kung fu, right? Yeah, of course. No, but I can't do any of these things. Now, this person wasn't really totally wrong because, that's all he could learn from TV, right? All Chinese, the great ping pong players, they're all kung fu movie stars. Wonderful, there are these people here in us, among us, but I'm not one of those. And what I'm trying to say is that there is a range, and when you try to stereotype people, you forget about the range, you forget about the diversity, and you just focus on this one little thing that you think is right in your mind. It's reinforced a lot of times by stereotypes. It's very, very highly simplified reality, highly, highly twisted kind of reality based on misinformation. Now, I'm not saying that when people have a stereotype, they are all wrong. In fact, they could be grasping on one fact, which is true. The problem is when you have one fact, there could be many truths. Okay. So something happened, it happened, is the fact. But the way we understand it, the angle we're looking at it, the levels that we use to understand and interpret this fact would be very, very different. And this is probably the first message that I would like you to be taking home, which is that, think again when we want to claim that somebody is like that or a group of people is like that. Think about which parts of it is a fact and which part of it is your interpretation, your truth. And bear in mind, there are many other truths, depending on your background, depending on your orientation. So we need to be putting all those together. Now, if this is such a dangerous thing, because I think a lot of the problems, a lot of the troubles in the world start with these kinds of misinformation, sticking to stereotypes, thinking that stereotypes are very useful, I would challenge you to say no to that. It doesn't work. It creates a lot of problems, it creates discrimination, it creates inequality, it creates all of the things that we don't believe in. So I want you to be thinking about these three things. One is that we do have a lot of information, so by all means, get all the information that you need. You know, think about the South Asians from different perspectives, go on Wiki, go on, you know, read your books and whatever. Create this kind of information for yourself, but don't believe in just one. Never believe in only one source. And I find it very difficult. You know, I don't blame you, because we live in such a fast-paced world, you want to get things done really, really quickly. So paper is due tomorrow, so I just want to go to Wiki and, you know, kind of paste something out. We can't do that, because this is not information. It's bits and pieces of things. And so what I want you to be doing is to remember that we don't want any ignorance, because it breeds fear, it breeds discrimination. And we need to get over with this. We need to be comprehensive, we need to be patient when we look at information. And think. I'm sure you're all intellectuals here, but remember to think. Because only when we think, we are able to create knowledge, all of this information. You know, use a lot of information, but remember to create your own set of knowledge, that which is only yours and yours alone. How do we do that? We want to use holistic observation. Don't just listen to people. Don't just get one experience with a South Asian, whether it's good or bad, and then just say that, no, all South Asians are like that. That can't be right. So you need to be holistic. Look at that person, watch, observe, and see what he or she does, right? Or what he or she does, despite what he or she says. So a lot of things you do need to be looking at and observing. And, oops, where is my slide? Here you go. Okay, so we need to be holistic as we observe. We need to be logically analyzing what we see. We need to be brave enough to say that, well, maybe I'm wrong. If I think this way, you know, let me think again. There are other ways of thinking about this. I think this is one very important thing to do. Let's prove myself wrong. And then you would go beyond and think new things, you get new ideas. And if you do that regularly, I'm sure you will be developing wisdom. We don't want only to have information, we have lots and lots of that. What we need is a group of people with knowledge, a group of people with wisdom. And when you are wise enough, you want to be making changes to the world. You ask yourself, what kind of world do you want to be living in? Is this the world that I like? Is this the world that I want to see? We all have a responsibility of making a change. So you need to know where you're going on forward, right? You need to be going this way or that way. You need to make a decision first. Perhaps one easy question to start with, you know, as you do this very complicated process, is ask yourself, how would you like to be treated? If you're in a situation like that, do you want to be treated like a South Asian? Or would you rather be even somebody else? Now that tells you something, that maybe inequality is going on, then how do I get away, you know, with this? I can't. Now so the first step is to have information. This is just to, you know, make you go through South Asia. It is a very complex concept, as you can see from the map. There's all sorts of cultures and languages, ethnic groups within this huge place. So all of this is South Asia. It's not a single concept, it's very, very diverse geographically and culturally. Back in Hong Kong, the South Asians are officially defined to be this group of people. Indians, Pakistanis, and Nepalese, and there's one group called Other Asians. Now why are they Other Asians? It's simply because the number is so little. There are about 2,000 of each. So the Sri Lankans, for example, the Bangladeshis, there are only about 2,000 people. So they all lump together like this, and altogether, the South Asians make up about 1% of Hong Kong's population. And this is probably one of the reasons or excuse of the Hong Kong government to be not doing anything, because the group is so small. Now, I think this is, again, wrong, but then, you know, it gives us a sense of how the South Asians are being created or defined. So South Asians, I put quotation marks around them, because you don't have a so-called natural primordial kind of group called South Asian. It is created, and identity is created in society. And so we create South Asians through putting them in boxes. But who exactly are the South Asians? They actually have come to Hong Kong for over 150 years. They came with the British back in the colonial era. So most of them were Indians coming here as police officers or soldiers working alongside Chinese colleagues. We've got traders and merchants like Modi, Sir Modi, you know, Modi Road in Tsim Sha Tsui, who gave a lot of money to Hong Kong News such that it could be established. So they're great philanthropists helping us, helping Hong Kong to develop our higher education, helping us to develop public transport. Star Ferry was an Indian endeavor. And then we've got the Nepalese who came in 1948 defending the border of Hong Kong. So all of them had their role to play, and we never really knew them. And so I just want to use these sets of pictures to tell you how diverse they now are. Very, very diverse occupations. They are, for example, spiritual leaders, clergy people. They are domestic workers, but at the same time, dancers, good, great artists, dance artists. Business people do a lot of trade along the One Belt, One Road, even before the concept was developed. And we've got our yoga gurus, social workers, community workers. But they're not just thieves, I have to say, they're not robbers. But most people would think that as long as you're South Asian, you have this potential to be bad. And I think it has to come from this structural or systemic issue. That is, they have been socially marginalized without access or having unequal access to very important social and cultural capital, such as education. Then we all sit here, you know, having the privilege of going through education quite comfortably, I would say. But think about the Nepalese. We were just talking about the Nepalese, how frustrated they get in just to get a so-called normal kind of education, trying to get into university. So it is very difficult. And so, with education, you don't have employment, you know, lack of education, lack of employment opportunities, difficulties in getting good health care, difficulties in practicing your own religion. And that partly comes from this, which I don't really like, but I have to show you this, because the ethnic hierarchy in Hong Kong is such that the whites tend to be staying on the top, you know, with Pris Patten, our last governor, representing the colonial power that we were subject to, you know, before 1997. And then you've got the Chinese, the next group, the Japanese, Koreans, right, the East Asians, and then you've got the Southeast Asians, South Asians, and then lastly, the Africans. Now, those of you who are, you know, sensitive enough will immediately see this is like, you know, putting people in a rank, a scale according to skin color. You're almost living in the 19th century, right? Putting people in slots just because of their skin color. So what can we do? Now, what I'm doing is to promote intercultural sensibility. I think having direct contact, having a dialogue, making friends, experiencing cultures directly are the most important things. Once you get into it, you know, being personal and feeling and thinking and observing both the differences and similarities, you will understand the diversity that this includes. We need to think, we need to read, discuss, and act. Because at the end of the day, you would find that, you know, if you are, you know, one person A, the other person B, you look very different, right? One is square, the other is brown, one is purple, the other is yellow, but when you look at them together, you see a lot of similarities, despite the differences. And when you put the cultures together, it's even more complex, right? Culture A is like that, B is like that, they all look very different if you just look at individual cultures. Put them together, you find that actually there's one big chunk in which we are similar. So we need to be looking at both and be able to appreciate both similarities and differences. And lastly, I just want to propose a measurement for you. Instead of, you know, trying to get an A or measuring your success through how much money you could earn every month, I would challenge you to think, you know, as a global citizen, am I having enough of intercultural sensibility? Try this. Do you have a lot of inter-ethnic partnership? Work together with different ethnic groups on things that are community-based, things that really need to be done on the community level. Second, do you have mutual empowerment? You help each other out. It's not like I have the resources, I come and help you, I provide a service to you. No, I don't think so. We all have so much to learn from each other. So even when you are in the mainstream, you're working with a marginalized group, you learn from them as well. So this is very important. Ethnic groups must learn from one another. And lastly, we don't want that work to just, you know, complete, finish, you know, project done, mark given, done. It's not like that. I think we need to keep it going such that whatever we do has this ripple effect that will go beyond your own project and be able to sustain this particular passion and make a change in the world. So with this slide, this is one of my favorite pictures. This is me in the field. I was in Nepal on top of the mountain in Gandruk in the village. I was staying with this family in three generations, the grandmother, the mother, and the child. And while we were talking about how traditional the Nepalese are, how, you know, how they stick to their own customs and things, you find that, well, things are changing. You've got this little girl coming in front and doing this. Right. So we do see a lot of changes in the world. We see a lot of changes in life. We need to be able to embrace it, be able to be open enough to think again, see again, and be able to feel that we are part of the world that could make a change. Thank you very much.